Hi guys, welcome to DevOps School. In this video tutorial, we are going to learn about Ansible Network Modules. Ansible Network Modules can configure your network stack, test and validate existing network state, and discover and correct network configuration drift. After going through this tutorial, I promise you that the concept and understanding of Ansible will be absolutely clear to you. This series divided into multiple parts, therefore subscribe to the channel and follow the playlist.
But before that, let me ask you a few things. Are you dreaming of a career with higher pay and more responsibilities? Or are you ready to take your skills to the next level this year? Then start investing in DevOps School certification level courses, which will help you to emerge skills for a wide range of entry-level roles and as well as higher potential future positions. But with thousands of courses online and in classroom worldwide, finding the right one for your career goals can be difficult. You can consider our courses like Agile Developer, Agile QA, DevOps Certified Professionals, Site Reliability Engineering, DevSecOps, and Masters in DevOps Engineering, where you will have access to well-structured, easy-to-follow course content that has been developed and will be delivered by industry professionals. You can join on our training programs globally through online platforms, and if you are looking for classroom workshops, then we have regular sessions available in Bangalore, Hyderabad, Chennai, Delhi NCR, Mumbai and in Pune. Simply compare our many courses, find the one that suits your style and schedule best, and start today.
What is DevOps? That's many people have asked, said they are practicing DevOps or they are trying to transition into the DevOps. Now, how Ansible is playing a good role in DevOps? These are the two questions I'm focusing right now. Then I will talk about why Ansible. First question, why Ansible? Because there are so many tools. You want to know why Ansible. And then we'll discuss on what Ansible, what is Ansible. Okay. Then we'll discuss about how Ansible. Okay, what, why, and how. Okay, so these are the questions which I'm going to explain through the discussions and get going. So guys, what is DevOps? So many of you have said it is you guys are in a transition of the DevOps. Many of you are already working in a DevOps. So what do you think? What is a DevOps? What is a DevOps? What is a DevOps? Let's make this session interactive. That way it will be better for me and all of us. So what do you think? What is a DevOps?
Development plus operations.
Anything else?
DevOps is a culture. It has people, product, and process.
Why we are using DevOps? Why we are using DevOps?
To reduce the delivery time.
Very good. That is one of the objectives. What else?
I would say initially DevOps was required to reduce the traditional conflict between the development and operations team, and to make the developer's life easy and let the developer to spin up the things, let the developer to spin up their infrastructure on their own using the concept of infrastructure as code.
Yeah, that is good. Yeah, but see, engineers don't want to implement DevOps. It comes from the organization's perspective, correct? Organization wants to adopt the DevOps principles. So what is the reason where organizations wants the DevOps? Okay, so I'll put it at the high goal. Okay, See here, everything you might be working from last 13 years, 14 years. Okay, I'm also working from last 40, 15 years. We have a certain goals. We means, when I say we, that means organization, have certain goals. And whenever you see this year, your organization introduce this tool, this process, next year they introduce new tools, new process, every time when you might get angry with them, because you might be saying, okay, it's working well, why we are having new tools, why we are having new trainings, why we are being transitions and all stuff like that, why we are wasting time on this, why we are not focusing on the things which we are already working. So this is called evolution, this is called improvement. So organization, more or less, they have a goals, what they want to do. So they have a goal, one goal which they have is immediate release. Immediate release. Okay, that means they want to reduce the release cycle. Now, when I say release cycle, that means think about it. Release cycle, then 1 year, 2 weeks, 5 minutes, 1 second possible. Immediate release. We were doing the release once in a year. Then we got once in a 2 week. Then we got once in a 5 minutes. And soon we'll be having second release also. Okay. So this is the goal. This is the goal, immediate release goal. We are transitioning into that. Now, if I say, can we start release in 5 minutes? That means 5 minutes means what, you know? Coding, testing, deployment in 5 minutes. Is that possible? You say, of course not. How can I do the 5 minutes release? Earlier, I was doing the release once in a 2 weeks. How can we do the release in 5 minutes? Now you must be wondering why we are having these releases reduced. Why? Why we are calling the trouble so much? The answer is very simple. We are having internet evolution. Okay, internet. Think about it. When we were having 1 year release, at that time, internet was not there, or maybe minimal accessible. We were running application not for the internet. We were running application in a desktop. Still, we are running application in a desktop. Correct? We were running, that was not connected to the internet. That means, in a simple way, if I want to use MS Office and you want to use MS Office, we don't need to connect to MS Office, each other. I'm owning my MS Office, you are owning Office, MS Office. I'm using without a dependencies on internet. But we got internet-based applications. Nowadays, we all, 99% of the time, just imagine 99% of the time, a typical computer user use the internet-based application. Okay, so this is the, we got internet. Now, the with internet, let's say we are using Ola for the commute purpose, transportation. Let's say if the Ola is down now in the early morning, you're trying to rush to the office, though we don't go office nowadays, and I don't think so we'll go office ever now. So we have a Ola, we commit transport to the office, and we are trying to book the cab, but Ola has a issues, some issues. So that issues will impact only you, or it will impact millions of users? You tell me. will it impact you or only you or one person, or it will impact everyone?
Yeah, millions of users, Rajesh.
Yeah. So let's say if you are having the Ola down, what you want to do? That time when you are trying to rush to the office and Ola is down, what you will do?
I will switch for Uber.
Yeah. Second day also is down. Ola is down. Then what you will do?
I'll delete the Ola app from my mobile.
Okay. Second day you will also switch to the user. So that means millions of people will switch to the Uber, right? So Ola has what? Ola has lost millions of users. On same time, third day you will not go to Ola. You will directly go to the Uber. Now here, if you Ola says, give me 2 weeks of time, I will fix that issues. We are working very hard on it. Have a patience. Be our honest client. Will you accept this reasoning? No. You want immediate, I mean, Ola wants immediate release. They have to fix it. This is a software which is running, which you are accessing. Software is written by human. This will have some faults. We do lots of faults. Nothing is perfect. So Ola needs immediate release. Not Ola, everyone needs immediate release, those who's running application on the server, internet. And now this, you see, you realize how many applications which you are using off the internet. Even MS Office nowadays, we are not using on a desktop. I remember from last 2 years, I hardly remember. I've used even many few incidents. I've used MS Office in laptop. Everything you have over there in the slides, PPTs, Excel, Access, everything you have in the online. So immediate release. Second goal is cost reduction. Cost reduction, when I say cost reduction, when I say that means reducing the running cost, the software running cost on the for the internet, reducing the software running cost and software development cost. Two things is there: running cost, development cost. So if organization wants to reduce the development cost, that means would they reduce your salary? Will you accept it? Of course not. You know that. So how would they reduce the development cost? So calculation is very simple. See here. Calculation is very simple. There is a one product, and here you develop five feature in 1 month. The cost of this development is 100 rupees. Worked by 10 people. Developed by 10 people. Now what about same duration, same budget? Instead of you develop 5, not 5, 10 features. So what do you think? The cost of the development reduced 50%. But the question is, very interesting question is, how can you transition to 5 to 10? That's the question. How can you develop, which we are developing 5 features now, we have to develop 10 features now in a month of same with the same budget. How can we do that? Because if you do that, my cost of production will be reduced by 50%. That's a huge action. You will say, I don't have a time, I'm a busy. Dev will say, I'm a busy, I don't have a time. QS will say, I don't have a time, I'm a busy. Architect will say, I don't have a time, I'm a busy. Everyone will say, everyone is not having time, they all are busy. So who will develop this remaining 50%, five feature? That is where we will destroy your setup. This is called cultural changes. You say what you are, you say, I'm a dev. I say what you are a QA. I ask what you are, you say, I'm an architect. I say what you are, you say operations, IT, network, database. And that is what I think that's a problem, integration problem. So let's destroy each and every role. Let's make it one role, DevOps. And do what? Everything. In a DevOps, you do everything. Only we need a 3% in the team. Only we need a 3%. A person code for product. I said one person. Same person. One person who's a coding for the product, or code for testing a product. Same person, you have to do the testing the product. And same person, one for coding for infra, for prod and dev. Same person. So in a DevOps, we need a person, only 3% we need. A person who can code for the product, and the person who can code for the testing the product, or the person who can code for the infrastructure and production. And sometime you have to become three. Sometimes you can become independent. So we don't need anyone else. This coding is important. Everyone has to code. So if you are getting scared from coding, you should not be in a DevOps team. Okay. So this is a thing. So now the question was, how to reduce this? What to do here? Answer is reduce wastage. Now, when I say reduce wastage, it's a full of discussion, full day of discussion. I'm not getting into that, but giving you high level. So here, cost reduction, running cost, development cost. For running cost, what should I do? So we started migrating from physical machine you know all this evolution you nothing new I'm talking about to virtual machines, and virtual machine to container. This is called runtime environment, platform. You call it this a platform. Okay. And in terms of software model, software development model, which are the model you are working right now? Software development model.
Waterfall.
Which are the software? Waterfall. So here you see, earlier when we had a release cycle 1 year, we had a waterfall model. Then we got a 2 weeks agile model. And now we need a 5 minutes DevOps model. Now, because of that, software architecture also has changed. Software architecture also has changed. So earlier we had a monolithic architecture, right? Now we got SOA, service oriented architecture. Then here we got a micro service architecture. See that evolution. See that evolution. Okay. Now, after the DevOps, we are also talking about DevSecOps. We are talking about the DevSecOps. One second, guys. Someone has knocking my door. Just a second. Give me 2 seconds. So sorry, because I'm staying alone and it's very difficult somewhere. Okay, so here, so we were discussing about monolithic to SOA, service-oriented architecture, and the microservices architecture. So this is the evolutions which we are going through. So last goal is, so goal of this immediate release, we change it, model. Which model we changed it here. We changed the architecture of the software also. And for the cost reduction, running cost, we changed this one, development cost, we changed this. And last one, improving a quality. Improving a quality. Because every organization, they want to improve the quality of the software. So every time, this is there since many years. Improve the quality. So then for the improving the quality also, better integration has come place. Integration between everyone. Those who's writing a code for the product, writing the code for the testing the product, writing a code for infrastructure and production and dev. So here, better integration. So this is the goal, what we have. Make sense? So guys, now you understand what is a DevOps. DevOps is one of the initiatives to do the immediate release, cost reduction, improving the quality. DevOps is a way to mitigate. Are you a dev? Are you QA? Are you architect? Are you lead? Are you manager? Mitigate every roles in a team, and only one person is there, that is called DevOps, who will do the coding also for the product, who will do the coding also for the testing the product, and who will do the operations. But how come one person can do everything? You must be working. The answer is hidden in this one. Now we are not at all doing lots of work. You are doing very tiny work, microservices. So let me give you the visualizations if you are not able to understand this. See, earlier we had a product. Hundreds of features were there and totally together in a one bundled EXE or whatever it is. This is called monolithic. But nowadays we have separated it out. This become a one service. This become one service. One service. One service. Separating out. Everything got isolated. Okay. And this service, let's say earlier you have a 20 minutes to build time and 10,000 lines of code, or let's say 1 lakh line of code. Now you have hardly 500 lines of code, 500 lines of code, 500 lines of code. Now this release is one, this release is 1.2. All are independent release. Don't need to affect anyone. 5.5, 6.2. So 20 people are working together. Here 2 people, 3 people, 1 people, 2 people, 3 people, 1 people, 2 people, 3 people. So you need to do coding for this product, code testing for this product, and operations also for this product. So is it possible or not? Because you are not managing 1 lakh of code. Hardly you are managing 500, 600, 10,000, 1,000 lines of code and doing faster releases. Because see, this was two release, this is a 6 release. So this is the world of microservices. you have to do everything. You have to become everything. And this build time will be 1 minute. Testing time will be 1 minute. Deployment time will be 3 minutes. Your task is done. Coding time, maybe a few times. Depends on your wish. So are you getting my points, what I'm trying to say? Guys, are you there?
Yeah, Rajesh.
Yeah.
So this is a DevOps. DevOps is one of the ways to cost reduction.
Rajesh. Yeah. Hi, Mohit here. I have a question. So doesn't this microservice contradict the logic of integration? As in, how is it better integrated when you have disintegrated all the services? Earlier, at least in monolithic, we had a view of that everything is consolidated. But in microservices, you have disintegrated each part of that product, and then any team can do independently what they want. So how that integration is managed at the end?
Yeah. So first problem was for this particular service. Okay, think about it. For this particular service, can I do the development, testing, and operations independently? That thing is yes. Now the question you must be having, how these hundreds of service will be integrated, correct? And working together. Yeah, for that we have a technology. So here you have a technology, containers technology. And here if you evolve a little bit more, you have Kubernetes. And then we have a mesh, service mesh we call it. Service mesh will solve that problem for you. Service mesh will solve that problem for you. Not everything will be done automatically. You don't have to do anything as such. You just have to set up the service mesh, you have to bring your platform to the container, put it in the Kubernetes and put it in a service mesh. Every magic will have happen automatically. This whole integration, security, certification, which service will talk to which service, microservice, everything will be done by this one. Running the services, everything will be done by this. Auto mode, you will have put it. So if you don't know, probably next training you should invite me for containers, Docker, then Kubernetes, and then service mesh like Istio or console or whatever. Okay, so this is a self-service, by the way. Once you understand and set up a platform, it will be self-service. Self-service means automatically will happen. You don't have to bother about it. You focus on the code. Ultimately, focus on the code. This one. Okay. So, guys, any other questions?
What is the difference between service-oriented approach and microservice?
That's a good question. Can I quick explanation here? Service-oriented architecture, I think you know that. I don't need to teach you. It's like, I'll put it in a simple way. Web server, talk to app server. App server, talk to database server. In between, you have a load balancer, load balancer, load balancer, load balancer. So here, this is called service oriented. This is a service, this is a service, this is a service, this is a service. And microservices is like a too many services. So too many services for each feature, you have a service. And for each service, you have a database. Make sense?
Okay.
It's a big topic, to be honest. So I'm not focusing right now, but just to give you that little bit high level. So SOE, you are currently working, whatever setup you are having, you must be having. It must be SOE. Okay. So guys, this is the world of DevOps. Where is the DevOps? You understood now. Now, but the question is, DevOps is not working actually, you know. Do you have all of your services migrated to microservices? No. Have you converted into the containers and Kubernetes? No. Have you got the releases of 5 minutes? No. So DevOps is not working. We make call, you know, we make call. We are a DevOps team, but actually it's not working. It's a myth. We are in the world of living in the myth, actually. We, none of the teams has got achieved to the DevOps, true meaning of the DevOps. Why? So many challenges are there. You know that. So many organizations realize that DevOps is not, cannot be implemented. If can be implemented, there's nothing better beyond that. If you can implement the DevOps in a true meaning, there's nothing beyond that. But soon Google realized that it will not be possible as we think. It will not be possible. So DevOps started failing, actually, because we all started running the DevOps from last 7, 8 years, 9 years, and we got enthused about it. We want to do all this thing. But the progress has become slowed down because of many reasons. And many people have realized that we are not addressing the real challenges of the DevOps. We are not evolving. Rather than we started branding ourselves as a DevOps, and we say DevOps, but none of the principles we follow of the DevOps. Then Google initiated one initiative, and that is called SRE. So SRE, Google said, let's not jump directly to everything. Let's jump everything in a phase wise. That means let's combine the development and QA effort, and let's call it a dev engineering, and let's put the operation not apart from that engineering, dev engineering team. Let's put it under the engineering only, and that's called ops engineering. So ops is not ops. Ops is being called ops engineering. So both are engineering team, dev engineering, ops engineering, and both will work together. Now both will be having different team, but will work together. And this model is become very popular nowadays, is being called SRE, site reliability engineering. That means the person who's taking all the initiative to make this microservices working or SOA working, and with the help of the dev engineering team. When I say dev engineering, include everything, okay, team, is being called as a SRE. So SRE is also one of the domain where we are focusing. So many teams don't want to go to DevOps anymore. Many teams say, let's go to the SRE. SRE was initiative taken by the Google in a 2000, long back, I guess I'm missing the year, but now it's become very mature. And you can see SRE related stuff from the Google website, Google team itself, and CEO, landing.google.com. So this is the one of the things which you can get through that. Okay, so this is the overall the things. Now, coming back to my question, how Ansible is playing a good role in DevOps? So basically, think about it. SOA, think about it, dev, think about the QA, think about a microservices. Okay, ultimately, if you go software-oriented architecture or microservices, okay, in all the scenario, you have so many server. Okay, you have so many server. Dev, you have so many server nowadays. QA also so many server. Microservices concept also having so many server. In a short production, so many server. The question is, so many server you have, this is called environment. Okay, this is called environment. And in environment, prod environment, dev environment, all this thing, you have multiple kind of server. We call it a group. Like a service, let's say DB service, or app service, app environment, app service, or load balancer, something like that. Correct? So see here, in an environment, you may have a hundreds of server. In this, you may have a DB environment, maybe 5, 10, 20. Like this, you may have a server. Okay? Let's increase the number. 40 or something, 70, something like that, remaining you have. So you have a different server running in your environment for SOA, development, QA, microservices, production. The question is only one thing. How can I change a setup in all server in one go? When I say setup, setup means you want to install, you want to configure, you want to uninstall, you want to change something. I said change management. All this setup, you want to change something. The something can be anything. Let me tell you, any kind of applications, any kind of files, any kind of things. But in one go is very important. One at a time. No, everything at a time, not one at a time. So how can you use that? How can you do that? Because you want the immediate release. Everything changes has to happen now, parallelly. And for that, you need Ansible. Okay, you need Ansible. In short, we will discuss more reasons about it. But right now, you see the complexity. See, there is only one person. Think about it. That person should be doing everything. How he can do everything alone? He needs lots of tools, lots of tools. And for that, you need Ansible. So if you want to know how much tool you should learn, I've created one Excel set recently. Okay, because my old URL, which I had created, it got outdated. And even I am getting the old URL, you can find it here. Here it is. So if you want to know in the Java world, what are the tools you should learn? Pre-production, left side is the problem, right side is the solution. Production, left side is a problem, right side is a solution, and platform. So see here, so many tools you have to learn in order to execute it. But actually, this is an old tool I created 3 years ago. Now I have to redo the things again, my step. I did it in Excel sheet. Soon I'll publish. Look at this here. So I'm just not talking alternative, only one tool for everything. Okay. Only one tool for him. So do you know Graph now? Do you know Elasticsearch, Splunk, PagerDuty, Slick, New Relic, Splunk, Prometheus, Datadog, Notary, Twistlock, Hashicorp, Vault, Jenkins, Consul, Istio, Invoy, Helm, Terraform, Kubernetes, JUnit, Spring Frameworks, Chef, Anspec, Ansible, which you are learning now, Nginx, Bootstrap, this is the programming stack, Selenium, HP, Artifactory, Gradle, MySQL, SonarQube, Git using GitHub, and some of the programming stack, Jira, Docker, AWS, virtual machines, and all software. So you have so many things in order to implement. Only one tool I have mentioned here, by the way, which is my preferred one. Okay. So these are the things. So here, how do you do the server management, server change management? So this is where you are going to use Ansible. So now, guys, enough introduction. You have any doubts, you have any questions, you can ask me. Any questions, guys?
Is Suren said. So could you give us an overview on what we will be covering? We obviously have seen the day one curriculum, so and we would be following that curriculum if I'm not wrong.
Yeah. Right. So basically, you'll be having the agenda already. So as per the agenda, we'll cover the same thing. So you don't have agenda?
Yes, we have.
Yeah, so don't worry about that. It will be covered.
Okay.
Any other questions, guys?
No.
Okay. So now let's get started with Ansible. What is Ansible? So guys, Ansible is a configuration management tool. Now the question is, what is configuration? I don't know what is a configuration. What is you're talking about configuration? So here when I say configuration, then we talk about the server. No, servers. S. Servers config management. So whenever you say Ansible and you say configuration management tool, don't talk about anything else but server. Why? Because configuration can be anything. AC configuration, room configuration, my bed configuration, my laptop configuration, my database configuration, my world configuration. It can be any configurations. Okay. It's a very broad word. But when you say Ansible and then when you say configuration, that means always server's configuration. Now the question is, you will have in your mind, what is there in server? I said server, not servers, because whatever you have in the servers, you will have in the servers, correct? So what is there in the server? So let's get these points from you only. Your laptop is also acting like a server. So can you tell me what is there in your server or laptop? I will write it down.
Operating system. Operating system, applications.
Huh. So packages, what else?
Hardware components.
Okay, CPU, RAM, storage. What else?
Hardening, standardization.
No, something better. What you see every day in the day-to-day life in a laptop.
We mean applications.
Applications I covered, no? Here is packages, is there. Okay, don't you see this is one thing which you see a lot and which we are forgetting it. Don't you see file? Right? So many different kind of files. Right? Your software file, third party software files. You modify a files, you change the files, change management. Remember, change management, configuration management, change management. So you change this file, right? You have a directory which you're forgetting. You have a users. Don't you interact with the service all the time? Yeah, don't you interact service? So like that, we have so many things. So in short, what is there in the server? So you have a hardware. Software. People. Process. When I say software, hardware. Software. People, define policies. Policies, we define the process. So we have in a server, what you see, you have everything. But the question is, can Ansible can manage the hardware? Is that possible? Is that possible? Ansible can manage the hardware? Is that possible? Guys, who can manage the hardware? Tell me.
Operations engineer.
No, in your environment, who's able to manage your hardware?
Hypervisor.
Yeah. So guys, hypervisor is one application. See here, hypervisor is one application. Hypervisor can manage CPU, RAM, storage. Now hypervisor is application. So yes, Ansible can manage hypervisor. And in the world of virtualization, everything, when you say CPU, RAM and storage, is just a file. It's just a file. So Ansible can manage file. So Ansible can manage hypervisor, CPU, RAM and storage. So yes, in short, let's understand that. What is Ansible? So everyone call it configuration management tool. But we need to know what is configuration management. Then we got to know, okay, we are talking about nothing but servers configuration management. The next thing is, what is there in the server? In the server, you have this one. So we manage, see, Ansible manage configuration of these and these through files only, these in server. Okay, in the server. That's the reason we call it Ansible is a configuration management tool. Did you understand that? What is Ansible? So if anyone asks you what is Ansible, will you be able to tell? You'll be able to tell?
Yeah.
Now why Ansible? Here I gave you the broader picture of it with the context of big picture, but here we have to talk about why Ansible. Here, why Ansible? Because it can deploy, when I say deploy or change, because many people like to use many things. So all the keywords I'm adding here. It can deploy or it can change or it can config. Whatever you love, you can use it, no problem. Can do multiple, do in multiple server, parallel. This is the reason we use the Ansible. Okay. Ansible is easy to learn, share, debug, test, extend. Means if you want to extend, compare to all programming language which you know, for example Java, .NET and stuff like that. It's easy. It's a DSL language. DSL. It's a DSL. Domain specific language. So if you want to use, why we should use Ansible? Because this can be done by any programming languages. But Ansible is easy. It's easy compared to all this. That's the reason we are using. Ansible is platform independent also. It can work in any operating system. Linux, Windows, all flavor of Linux, it can work with. Now, Ansible is idempotent also. This is the reason we are using. Now you have to tell me what is idempotent. We have a many engineers who's from anything as a service here. So you tell me what is IDOM portal. And this feature is common nowadays in many, many tools actually.
We can execute it a number of times. It will have the same configuration as it is.
Right, yes. That's correct. What he's saying, you execute Ansible 10 times, but the results will be same. For example, I'll put it in a simple other way, my definition. See here. There are 10 steps in a one deployment. And there are many places you might find the spelling mistakes. Please ignore it. For time being, I'm not focusing too much on each word. So there are 10 steps. Okay. Each step takes 1 minute. So it will take 10 minutes. Right. And if you do deploy through, let's say shell scripting or anything, so it will take 10 minutes, 10 steps. Out of it, other programming languages. Or first, let's say first deployment. First deployment you are doing through the Ansible. First deployment. So 10 steps, 10 minutes. But if you do the second deployment, in the second deployment, there's a only 2 steps got changed. Remaining is same. So in this case, only 2 will execute. Only 2 will execute. So how much time it should take? As per the rule of IDOM portent, 2 minutes. Simple. So you saved 8 minutes. So what I am trying to tell you, Ansible has an inbuilt capability. That's the inbuilt property to check before doing the things if it has it done or not. Let's say I'll put it in this way. You want to start the service after doing some changes. So Ansible will check. Is this the service already running? Then why to start it? Waste of my time. Don't start it. Okay. If the service is already available, don't start it. Don't start it. Leave it. Skip it. So that kind of property you won't find in the shell scripting or scripting which is written using Python, Perl, Java, Shell, whatever it is, PowerShell. You have an Ansible. So this is the same feature you can find in the Terraform, Ansible, Puppet, Chef, the CloudFormation, Azure RM. So all these things, you will find this property. Before running, they will check. Is it really done? Not done, then do the changes. If it is done, don't do that. So you check the resources in each server. Yes. This feature of checking it, the resources before doing it is called IDOM portent. Very powerful functionality. Did you understand this? Did you understand this?
Yeah, we got it.
So yes, guys, there are so many other benefits are also there, like a business benefit for CEO and CTO. I will not talk about this one because we are engineers. Let's stick to the engineering topics only. So yes, cost benefit, speed up of deployment, saving time, this, that, and all, we have anyways. So now, guys, yes, we discuss about what is Ansible, and then we discuss why Ansible. Before going into the how Ansible, let me complete that. This is a tool from Red Hat. By the way, Red Hat also got acquired by some company, I think IBM or something. Okay. This tool is written in Python. Okay, written in Python. They have a 2 release basically. One is community release, one is enterprise release. Community release is a command line. Okay, that means you can work with the command line. Same feature. Here command line plus GUI. What we call it? This we call it Ansible. This we call it Tower. Okay. Now this is free. This is open source. This is a paid. Okay, so this is the release difference between the two release. I'll teach you both, okay, by the way. And what else? So yep, powered by you know why Ansible we are all are learning because of this reason only. It's not about Ansible is the only tool which can do the change management, configuration management and all. No, we have so many tools, but this is something make it very popular. Ansible make it very popular. What is that? Modules and roles. No. Ansible is not agentless. By the way, many people say agentless. It's not agentless at all. Okay. If you want to know why it is not agentless, according to me, then you have to stay till this topic, how Ansible works.
Okay.
And you decide whether it's agentless or not, or not. Not me. Okay. So powered by thousands of modules and roles. Now, what is the modules? I'll teach you anyways. And what is the roles? I'll teach you. But these are the reasons for that Ansible is popular. Okay, guys. So now more or less we discuss about what is Ansible, what is the configuration management with respect to Ansible, and why Ansible. Any questions before hitting to the topic, which is how Ansible?
Rajesh, now, you said Ansible is a configuration management tool. Can we use this for orchestration purpose?
Yes, we can use. Let me tell you here. See here. A similar way, Ansible can talk to hypervisor. So Ansible can talk to not hypervisor. When I was trying to tell you, Ansible can talk to any packages, any application, and that package will do the orchestration. Okay. So if you think Ansible has that feature, no. But Ansible can talk to n number of tools. Yes. So that way, yeah, you can do that. So which one you are using for orchestration? Cloud,
public cloud.
AWS. Ansible can talk to any tools, any applications, and for this AWS is one platform. So Ansible will talk to the AWS and AWS will do that thing for you, but instruction will be given by Ansible, so that is possible anywhere.
Okay, got it.
So that's the reason. No, here you have 4,000 modules. Where is that? Yeah, all this thing make it possible because of that modules. But Ansible has no property as such to manage your platform. Ansible will outsource this work to someone else. Guys, any other questions?
No, I think.
Okay. So I think if you do not have any questions, then we are done with the introduction part. So now you know what is a DevOps, where DevOps stands, and why Ansible is playing a good role in DevOps, and all this thing. So now next question is how Ansible works. So before that, let's have one.
Rajesh, it's 11, Rajesh.
Yeah, I was talking about, yes. Even I need it, actually, to be honest. I need to go to restroom. So that's the reason I was looking at my watch all the time. So, yeah. So, yes. So let's have a 15 minutes of break, 1:05, not 5:00. And we'll wrap. We'll again come back, and then we'll resume that next question, which is called how Ansible. Okay for everyone.
Yeah.
Okay, guys, then see you for after 15 minutes. Bye. Shubhash, can you pause the recording?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So now, next question is how Ansible works. More or less, it's like architecture. Okay. So here, in Ansible, we have a one component, and that is very important, human. Okay, so human interact with ACS, and ACS interact with ARS. Now, what is a human? I'm not going to define because you know that. And here, what is ACS called? For Ansible Control Server. And ARS, what is stand for Ansible Remote Server. So let's have some visualization. So probably we'll get it.
Rajesh, are you typing something in the notepad? Because we are not able to see. Yes. Sorry, I'm not able to see. It's freezed in the same screen.
Yeah, it looks like it freezed. Yeah.
Okay. Let me share one more time. What you are seeing right now?
Yeah, now we can able to see.
Yeah. MS Paint, right?
Yeah, MS Paint, yeah.
Yeah. So here what we have, this is us, and we connect to the ACS. This is ACS, and ACS parallelly connected to multiple ARS. These are the parallel ARS. This is the ARS. Okay, so ACS we have one, ARS can be multiple. This is the server which where we want to deploy change management. You want to do anything you want to do, you do that in this server. Okay, so now let's talk about it. Human should know what commands. Okay, that's all. Ansible commands. What are the commands? I'll show you that later point of the time once I show you the demo. First, understand that. And ACS, it has to be Linux only. Okay, it has to be Linux, and it is a 64-bit. Okay, it has to be Linux, and it has to be 64-bit. Whereas in ARS, it can be anything, Windows, Linux, anything. And it can be anything. In terms of bit also, it can be anything. Okay. So there is no as such specification. Here it can be Windows, it can be Linux. Now, ACS, you should be having Ansible installed. Okay, here in ARS, nothing should be installed. Okay, that means in Ansible ARS, you should not be having. But real things start from here, and that's the reason you call it's a agentless, by the way, because ARS Ansible Remote Server is having nothing installed. That's the reason you call it. But actual real things start from here. When it is ARS is Windows, then you need to have a few things which is important. If these few things is not there, then ARS will not work. And that is .NET and plus one thing, WinRM. Okay. Why? Because Ansible connect, ACS connect to the Windows machine through WinRM. WinRM and protocol, which is called HTTP. When ARS is Linux, then it connect through the SSH, and protocol is SSH only. Okay, so this is the difference. So here ACS, when it connect to the Windows ARS, then WinRM protocol, WinRM tool, protocol HTTP, and ACS when they connect to the Linux machine of Windows ARS, Linux machine of ARS, then SSH protocol, SSH method. So that's the reason. When ARS in Windows, then you need to have a .NET and WinRM. But when it is a Linux, then it has to be SSH and Python. Yes, that's true. SSH and Python. Okay. And one more thing which I must write it, I'll forget it. PowerShell. Now what happens is, because all the Windows nowadays, after 2016 onwards, all the Windows comes with the WinRM, and earlier Windows, they used to come with the .NET and PowerShell. So because of this, you are not installing anything new, which is already available. Okay, already available. So that is the reason we call it agentless. Ansible is agentless, but just remember, if you do not have this one, Ansible will not work. If do not have WinRM running, Ansible will not be able to connect. So it's a preconditional. So we cannot say agentless in real way. In Linux, you see nowadays any flavor of Linux you see, when you experience it. SSH by default you get it, Python by default you get it. It comes along with every operating system of Linux. So that is the reason we say, agent, Ansible is agentless. But it's up to you how you view. If your operating system SSH is not there, Python will not there, ACS will not be able to connect with ARS. In your Windows, if these are not there, ACS will not be able to connect to ARS. So did you understand that? Why we call it agentless? Why we call it not agentless? Make sense?
Yeah.
Yes, Rajesh.
Okay. So now let's move on. So we have understood how Ansible works. Now next thing is, what is a role in Ansible? What is a role in Ansible? Also there are two roles actually.
Rajesh, I think you said before break that you are going to explain about how modules are running in the how Ansible works.
I'll talk about it. How modules are running, that is pending, right? I have not discussed modules, so how modules is running, I'm not talking.
No, okay.
I have not discussed module, right? There's no module as such right now in my discussion. Correct, na?
Okay.
So modules, when I bring that module, then I'll talk about the how module. Got it?
Rajesh, thank you.
Yeah. So now the question is, what is our role? What are the roles we have in Ansible? Like each one of us has joined this one. What do you want to do? So here we have a two role, dev role, QA role. Okay, dev and QA. Okay. So what is a dev, Ansible development? What is a, sorry, not QA, admin. What is a Ansible development? Because here dev engineering, dev and QA together. And admin operations, whatever you want to call it, is up to you. Okay. So what is the role of a dev? So basically role of dev, I don't know. What is the role of Ansible dev? I don't know. But I am asking you, let's say you want to become a developer. How you want to become a developer? Can you tell me? Become a Java developer or .NET developer or anything. How can you become a developer? Let's say you are just got into the college. So tell me step by step how to become Java, .NET, C, C++ developer. First thing and last thing, one by one. Tell me what we do.
I'll have to learn Java first.
Okay, before that you do something else also. Remember your college time. I collected, by the way, I collected out of 4 months, I collected 3 months only CDs of Java. But after that you do something.
Before learning Java, you need to know the OOPS concept.
No, but did you not install Java JDK? Correct. First thing, I'll tell you my story. We had a trimester concept, so 4 months. So out of 4 months, 3 months, I collected CDs of Java. And then in the last 1 month, 25 days, I installed JDK 3 or 4, I don't remember. I think 4 only. So JDK 4, I installed it. And after that, I left once again 25 days. So installation I did, and then I left again for 5 days. Just before exams, let's say 2-3 days is there. Then after that, we started learning Java. So when you start learning Java, so when we write a programs, we write a programs in what language, I mean, what file, what extension of file? Anyone? Anyone? So Java program is stored in some files, right?
Dot Java.
What? Yeah, dot Java. Dot Java, let's say dot C, dot CPP, dot Python, dot P, Perl, right? So any programming language, PL, sorry, not Perl. Perl is not a extension, PL. Okay. So any programming language which you store that file, dot Java. So yes, I also did store the file in dot Java. But what we did, Hello World programs, stored it. And then after that, when I compiled this program, then we got a dot class file, didn't we? Or dot object file in CPP, didn't we?
Yeah.
So any programming language process is almost same actually. Okay. Now, important thing is, here we started learning Java. So guys, which are the things you learned in any programming? I'm talking about Java only alone. Any programming language. What are the things you learn? You tell me from start, but you tell me if you can recall. Or maybe some of you must be developers now itself. So tell me first thing, what you do, what you will teach to your junior, or what you have learned as a process to become a Java developer, or any other developers also.
Syntax, variables.
Variables. First we learn variables. It's different kind of variables.
Declaration and initialization.
Yeah. Then we learn operators. Correct? Then we learn conditioning. Then we learn looping. If you remember, these are the part of every programming language. We learn variables, operators, conditioning, looping, correct? All this thing we learn. Put it up in the dot Java file. Okay. And then we compile the Java, it become a dot class file. Now, once you have a multiple Java, multiple class file, what you do typically? multiple class, multiple jar file. Guys, are you there?
Making a jar file.
Yeah, you got it, jar file. By the way, guys, do you remember in the .java file or CPP file, there was one method, you know, function method, you know that, right? Correct. But there's, when you call the this Java file, that method used to be called default. Do you remember default method?
Public static.
Do you remember
void main?
Public static void main. Main was the default method. Remember? Yeah. So main method was a default method. Don't forget. Default concept, don't forget. When we call compile the Java, or when we compile the jar, there is a default method will get executed. Don't you think so? And this main method will call all the sub other methods also. Hope you remember. Okay. If not, hello world, Java, or any program. I'm just not saying Java only. Any program concept is same. See, public static void main. This is my main method. That means if I compile this program, this main method will execute. This is a class. This is a method. And that's the reason you have a hello world. Understood? Okay, cool. So now we have multiple classes. Remember main method concept. When you have multiple classes, you put it in a jar file. Guys, once you have a multiple jar file, what you will do? Any idea?
ER file.
Yeah, EAR file. Can I call it var file for time being? Var file is more popular than ER file. Yeah?
Okay.
So var file. Var file has many more things. Again, I'm telling you. Var file is having many more things. I'm discussing here. Jar file you have. Jar file you have. And in var file you have a manifest file. Okay. Plus CSS file. Plus JavaScript. Plus HTML. Plus XYZ. Database file also. So many things. So var file is a complete package for your application. Complete package. So this is the journey of how to become a Java developer. Good journey, right? So now let's back to this. What are the roles in an Ansible? So guys, there are two roles. Understand this. There are two roles. Dev role, admin role. What you will do? This role, a person who would write a code and test a code. Simple. That's all. A person who would write a code and test the code. Here, a person who would apply a code in infra and manage infra. You can call it ops or focus. It's okay for us. This is all. Now, this code is important, you know, code is important. Because this guy is applying the code in infra and managing the infra. When he says managing the infra, that means which is the list of environment. Here I did discuss actually somewhere. Somewhere I discussed. Huh, see. You have so many environment, different kind of machines, dev machines, in each environment, database machine, application server machine, load balancer, web server, different kind of machines you have. Credential, certificate, all these things you have. Now code is important. What is the code? So guys, next question is, you should be asking me how to become Ansible developer. Because the code is, you have to write a code and test the code.
Once you complete this work, then admin work will come. A person who would apply the code in infra and then manage the infra. Okay, so you have to play in the next 5 days. You have to become a both person. You have to become a dev also, and you have to become a administration also, admin operations also. I'll call it operation. That will be easier for you. Operations also. So how to become an Ansible developer? That's a question. So guys, it's not about Ansible developer. Any developers, you have to install JDK. That means here, development kit in Ansible is Ansible. Match the with Java. Okay. Match with the Java. So in the Java developer, you install JDK. In Ansible developer, you install Ansible JDK kit, development kit DK. Install Ansible is a development kit. Okay, when you install Ansible, you get more than 25 tools. Yes, so you should call Ansible ADK actually. ADK, but we call it only Ansible. Why? I don't know. Okay, but after that, you will write a program. In the Java, we write a dot Java. Here, we write a dot YAML. Yes, we write YAML. So why YAML? What is YAML? Now I will little bit help you during the training, but you have to learn from yourself many things. But I can tell you how we got evolved. This I can tell you because quick discussion can be possible in between. Okay, by the way, so, by the way, Babu, are you there in this call? Srinivasan?
Yes, I'm here.
Yeah, Bala?
Yeah, Rajesh, I'm here.
Balaji?
Yes. Yes, I'm here.
Chandar? Madhu?
Yes. Yes.
Guru?
Yeah, I am.
James?
Yeah, I mean.
Jeremon? Jeremon? Jagdishan?
I think Jnaneshwar.
Lakshmi Narayan Ramchandra?
Yeah, I'm good.
Mohit, Mohit Sharma, Shivashankar,
yeah, I'm in.
Nagesh, Mattagi, Arun, Ramraj,
yeah, I'm here.
Surendran Saramugnam.
Yes.
Sridhar? Rajesh?
Yes.
Senthil?
Yes, sir.
Suresh?
Yes, Rajesh.
Tamil?
Yeah, I hear Rajesh.
Venkatesh?
Rajesh.
Okay, great. Okay, so now back to the topics here. So yes, we were learning how to become a Ansible development. So we said, first step you have to install Ansible. How to install, I'll teach you, but it's not difficult. You understand conceptually, then you'll never get stuck. So first you install Ansible to become a developer. Then you write YAML file. But the question is, why YAML? Because I said very clearly, Ansible is written in Python. Where is that? Python. So why not Python? Why YAML? So let's understand this journey. So earlier, we were developing a software. Then we were using compile language. You know that compile language, like a Java, C++, .NET. These are the compile language. You compile and then create a binary and then human. So human write in one language. Then you compile to machine language. Machine understand different language. Now compile language when you want to develop a software, use software development cycle used to be 2 years, 3 years, 4 years and stuff like that. Because everything you have to write your own, everything from scratch, every features, every organization, they have to write it their own. Then we wanted to reduce the development cycle. Okay, development cycle. We wanted to do the faster development. Then we got a interpreted language. Interpreted language. Now when we got the interpreted language, like a Perl is an interpreted language, Python, interpreted language, PHP, very popular interpreted language. So in these languages, what you do the fast software development, very faster. Now let's say if you develop one product in 1 year in Java, so in a 6 month in a PHP, something like that. Very fast software development or Python. But what has happened? How we world has become a one now, global. Nowadays we don't write a programming language. We don't write a software, sorry. Nowadays we don't write a software. Most of the time, if you look at this, we consume the software which is written by other people with the help of internet. You need a CSS libraries, don't need to write from scratch. Download the bootstrap. You need a JavaScript library, don't write in from scratch. Download jQuery, Angular, this, that. You need a Java based all the modules, basic modules, go for the Spring Boot. PHP, you have this one. In Python, we have a Flask. In PHP, I just forgot the name. I use a lot. Okay, so different framework has come. So with the help of the framework, we don't write a programs. Now we use all this pre-built activity. So from the compiled language to interpreted language, and interpreted language to we got a declarative language. Declarative language. Now what is a declarative language? I'm just talking about the declarative language. Here we got a XML declarative language, YAML declarative language, JSON declarative. Very, very, very fast. So nowadays we use YAML or JSON very fast. So what is this YAML and JSON? Do you write a program? No, not at all. What do? You just declare it. Yes. You don't write a program. You declare it. What you declare? Whatever you want. You want something. You want to copy a file. Just declare a copy of file. Declare, not write a program. Again, understand the writing of programs and declaring your desire is a different thing. So you declare, who will give it to you? Will be given by domain specific language. For declaration, we got a domain specific language. We call it specific language. There's so many domain specific language, guys. When I say domain, it means particular domain. So in the world of Ansible, we are learning Ansible. So Ansible is a domain specific language. Okay. So you see here how this relation. You human want something, declare, not writing a program. Again, I'm repeating multiple times, you might feel bored. But human write? No. Human declare? Yes. Where? In YAML. And send to the domain specific language Ansible. And Ansible or Groovy or like this or like a Gradle, they will do the all the magic. All the magic will be done by Ansible, because Ansible is designed for domain, one particular domain. Which domain? Configuration management domain for servers. Like that, we have a thousands of domain specific language. Thousands. Okay, so many. You have more than 43 languages, more than 300 programming framework, so many, you get lost. Let's not get lost. Stick to the points. Domain specific language for us right now for Sensible, because we don't want it to write the same program and again. Every organization should not write. So Ansible is a domain specific language. YAML is a declarative language. We declare in YAML and send to Ansible. Ansible will do that and then give you the results. But guys, domain specific language cannot interact with the machine. Yes, that's the problem. Domain specific language cannot interact with the machine. And that is where every domain specific language has been designed with the help of compiled language. Compiled language or interpreted language. And that is the reason you see here Ansible has been designed with the help of Python, which can interact with the system. See here how this relationship, because human, see, it's very simple. Human don't want to write nowadays program, because why? All the program already has been written. How much you will write? So now the time has to come for declare it. But how? YAML or JSON? You declare to what? Domain specific language, Ansible. Ansible would not get you done the things. So Ansible will talk to the Python. So are you getting this relationship? Are you able to understand this relationship?
Yeah, Rajesh.
So the question is, in YAML you declare, but what you declare to Ansible? That is an important question. I'll come back to that. Okay, that the question is again same. What you declare in YAML, so Ansible understand, and Ansible ask the Python to do that same thing. That relationship between these things is covered by one word that is called module. Now, what is a module? I will not cover now. You get confused. So I'll come back in some time, but let's complete this discussion. How you want to become an Ansible developer? So guys, you have to write, first install Ansible, then you write YAML. And I told you this story here. And YAML, once you have a multiple YAML, you will put, once you have a multiple, this YAML, what we call it, you know, playbook. Now don't get confused, we call it playbook, but still it is a YAML file. We store in the playbook. We store in a YAML, but we call it playbook. Now, what is a playbook? Again, I will come back to that topic in some time. Wait for me to come back. But that is a YAML file. Once we have a multiple YAML file, like you have here, you have a multiple Java file, same concept. And here, guys, the compilation is not there. Why? Because, you know, it's a declarative language. Compilation is not there. This is created through the Ansible Python. So Python is interpreted language, so you don't need to compile. It will happen automatically. Okay, so YAML. Now, if you have a multiple YAML, then what we do, we call it a role. Okay, but you think, see, var file, do you have only jar file? No, it has a manifest file also, CSS file also, JavaScript files, HTML, that will make your software running, right? So like that role, you don't have only playbook. Actually, string, I will put it string here. Just why I am putting string? Because this is wrong. Roles will not have a playbook, but I'm teaching you playbook. Why? Because I want to have a little bit simple flow. So I'll come back to this complication. So you have a multiple playbook. Once you get a, you have a role. Role will have a playbook plus many things like a files, template, handler, variables, all this thing will have it. But not complicating now. It's very simple. So now one thing, guys. no matter whether you go for the declarative language or interpreted language or compiled language, this will not leave. This will stick forever. Any programming language, variables, operators, conditioning, and
we missed data types, I guess. We missed data types.
Variables.
Okay.
Variables is the data types, now. Some programming language we call it a data types. Some programming call is we variable. Variable types, data types. Correct? No?
Yeah.
So this is the one. So how to come Ansible, how to become, how to not come, how to become Ansible. So first you have to install Ansible, then write YAML file, then write a role. In YAML file, what you'll have? Variables, operators, conditioning, and looping, and all stuff like that. So far, so good. Guys, did you understand that? Any questions? Any questions, guys?
Rajesh, from a public view perspective, to start with, these specific playbooks are available within the Ansible modules, or how is it?
The answer is hidden in this. Any more questions?
I mean, hidden in the sense that you will be explaining components of ACS.
Yeah. Okay, guys, any other question? Okay, so you know that now what you want to do. Remember that, you remember all these things. Playbook, YAML, role, variable, operator, conditioning, looping, files, playbook, templates, handler, variable. All these things, if you want to become a developer, you have to know all this. You have to know all this. Same way, you know Java. So now let's discuss about, this is important, ACS. If you forgot what is ACS, let me recall. This is ACS, human interact. This guy interact with all ARS, very simple. So what is the ACS component? So first thing in ACS, you will have Ansible installed, the one which you have here. The moment you install Ansible, you get modules config file. Okay, so when you install Ansible, you get modules and config file. So Ansible is a software. You think one software? No, not at all. Ansible is a software, is like a development kit, DK. Will get you so many Ansible executable, so many. Minimum, I think 15 to 20, I guess. 15 minimum. But it will get you modules also. But the question is, what is the modules? I don't know. But it will get you the configuration also. Configuration file. What is the configuration? I don't know. We'll come to know. There is one more component what we have in Ansible, which created by human. Inventory. We create inventory. This inventory, I'll put in a string by admin. Remember, guys, here I said already. Where is that? Ops. Let me use ops. See here, very clear defined role. What are a role in Ansible? Of developer, who person who write a code and test a code. So basically here, if I redefine,
Understood, guys? You have to write a playbook or role, one test playbook and role. And now, guys, I'm rewording each word. When I say authentication, see what operation will do, whatever the role will be given by or playbook will be given by dev team will apply on the infra. What is infra? Inventory. And manage infra means manage the authentication and authorization. Okay, authentication means to inventory. So what is inventory basically? Inventory is a file. No, it's wrong. Inventory is a concept which would have following. Understand me. Localhost. List of IP address over command line list of IP address over file in file, sorry. List of IP address in script, list of IP address in directory. Very complicated. Now, this is INI format, file will be INI format, script anything. Any script, usually Python, and directly you know that, so I don't have to tell. So what is inventory? Localhost, you know that. List of IP address of what?
Remote servers.
Yes, remote server. List of IP address you can pass over the command line. Yes. And one more thing, please understand this. When I say list means list, list means list separated by comma over the command line. Now you have to ask, how can we provide the list of IP address in file? List I said list, so you have to use INI format. Okay, if you convert in INI format the file, then only it will be list separated by line. So here the new line means, in the INI format, the new line means new line. New list means new file, new line. In a script, how you generate a list through the programming language is conditional, because each programming language list is different format and direct. So guys, there's so many things actually. So ultimately, what is inventory? So when I call inventory, that means where you are running your script. Simple. It can be one machine, it can be thousands of machines. See, playbook, role, run on infra, inventory, and manage infra. So here, run on infra, just read this word. Run on infra, infrastructure. What is that called? Inventory. In short, we call it I'll come back to that. So guys, what are the components of ACS server? So you will install Ansible, you get
modules, you get configuration. Who will develop this one? Inventory by operations. I'm writing it also. And then playbook also roles, but now you know what is the roles at high level. Not I'm deep diving into. We have 5 days, lots of time we have to get. Understand at the high level. Role is nothing but a combination of playbook and multiple things, but we'll discuss. Playbook, you understand for time being, you write in the YAML file, and then who write it? Dev write. Inside the playbook, we have all the logics which will be done and stuff like that. So here, playbook, who writes it? Which is shared by dev and used by operations. Okay. So guys, ultimately, these are the components of ACS. Conceptually, if you have understood, then I will deep dive. Did you understand?
Rajesh, can you show us a demo or what is a playbook and what are these inventories and all that? If you have an inventory,
long way to go. Demos time is long way. First, understand each and every component.
No, I'm just asking about the files, the playbook files, the inventory files like that.
Yeah, conceptually, first you understood, and then I'll show the demo. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Any questions on this part, guys?
Rajesh, list of IP address in directory. Direct instance, it's a folder, right? So inside the directory, we'll have to create a file or something, right?
Yeah. I'll show you the conceptually understand right now. Doing the things will be much easier. Trust me. It's not very difficult. Ansible is very easy. Okay. So if you have understood so far, now let's deep dive each component. What is modules? Guys, module means what? Modules mean what?
Collection of different functionalities or programs.
Yeah, correct. So modules means it would do one work. Simple. It would do one work. For example, CP, what it'll do? One work, copy. MKDIR, what it will do? One work. RM, what it will do? One work. SART service related work, what it will do? One work. Installing package, what it will do? One work. So what is a module? One work. It will do one work, not a two work. It will do one work. And here require parameter. But from where? From human. Okay. Or script. What is a parameter? Sometimes you call it parameters, sometimes you call it arguments. Different programming language. For example, CP, it will do one work, copy. But parameter, what to where? Are you getting my points or not? Guys?
Yes.
Yeah.
CP, you need a parameter. What do you want to copy? Where do you want to copy? Or MKDIR, required parameter. What do you want to do? Or service you want to start? Which service you want to start? Or let's say RM, what file you want to delete? What you give the parameter. So guys, module is nothing but a piece of code in built at ACS, which comes with Ansible installation. Simple. I'll deep dive, just be with me. What is a module? It's a piece of code inbuilt with at ACS, which comes along with the Ansible installation. What it will do? It will do one work. Don't think, and sorry, my mistake. It's not a module, modules. No, module. It's not a module. One module will do the one thing. Simple. So it will do one work. Require parameter from human or script. Now, guys, written in. This module is written in any programming language. Yes, that's the beauty about this. That's where I love Ansible. You can written in any programming language, but if you want to have it, that functionality, what we call it, agentless functionality, then for Linux, you write in Python. And for Windows, you write in PowerShell and .NET. Are you getting my point? What I'm trying to say? Okay. So module is written in a Linux, Python, or Windows, PowerShell, and .NET. If you want to have a platform independent function. Okay. Now the question is. I got to know, I learned, okay, that's fine. It's a piece of code. When we install Ansible, we get it. But each module will do one task. Each module, it will do one task. And require parameter, of course, for any task, you have to give the parameter. That's okay. And written in any programming language, you can write in any programming language, but you have to write in this one for to make it understanding. And platform independence. Now the question is, where I would find list of all modules, all parameters? That's the question. Can you ask Ansible command line tool which you installed it? We will give you, but I will not use that one because of only one reason. GUI is more powerful than command line. So here I will write in Google Ansible module list. See module index. This page, you will find all the language, all the modules, which is shared and developed by Core Ansible. Guys, modules you can write also, by the way, but that's a different question also. Here. All modules are here. Now, same modules you can get on the command line through after installing the modules, but it's not very easy, comfortable reading it. Even I get irritated. So refer this document. It's official documents. Always latest. Okay, you see latest. Okay. So here these modules has been divided into the category. And if you remember, please read it one more time. So do you think any possibility where we can cover all these languages, all the modules? Even though you spent 2 years dedicated to Ansible and you want to finish that Ansible whole, you will not finish. So there's so much of modules lying over there. So much of modules is lying on the github.com. So no, but strategies will have to learn. That's one. And where do you find out the, so let's go to the modules, let's say file-based model.
Again, these are the modules. Out of which you want to copy, module copy. You want to search something, module find. If you want to do stats, module stats. If you want to create a file, module file. You want to content modification, block in file. You want to archive, zip, archive mode. You want to replace something in the file, replace mode. You want to archive, archive mode. So many things are there like that. If you go here, each directory you just click messaging mode, rabbit echo, system mode. Utility modules. So guys, so many modules are there here, and then github.com. So important thing is, next question, each module has a parameter. You know what is a parameter now. So where do you find out all the parameters? So guys, go to the each module first. Files, file. First read this. Then read this, and then read this. And this table you will get on the command line also, but I am asking you to refer it official website only, because life will be easy. I want, okay, life should be easier. But if you want all this documentation, Ansible doc will give you all this thing, but it's irritating over there. Now for the file module, what are the parameters? Access time, access file format, attributes, follow, force, group, mode, modification time, owner path, and that. See your long list. Now each parameter has a type, string type. Boolean type, string type, path type, string type. So each parameter has a type, and each parameter is added that functionality in the Ansible version. So this functionality has added in 2.7. This is also 2.7, like that. Now each parameter, there is a some default value or choices available. Okay, some default value or choices. So here for access time, there is no choice and there is no default, nothing. Okay, that means you can provide, it's a, you can decide what you want. Okay, but there are some here. If you go mode or state is a very frequently thing. State is important parameters. You should always look at any module state. You should look at it. Okay. So any module, you have to look at the state. Why? Because state is an important parameter. Okay. And here you have a choices. These many choices, but if you do not select, default will be applied file, like see here, choices, default. Default is in the green, blue, always. See here. Now what is the meaning of absent, directory, file, hard, link, status, attach? You can read it here. So this is the way. Now you
calculate. How could you understand the mandatory parameter?
Mandatory require. See here.
Okay.
Red you will be having required. If there is no mandatory, that means there is no required. So guys, this table you have to understand. If you understand one table, you understand all tables. And if you do not understand, just read one more time.
how many modules you have? 4,000 modules. And how many modules parameter you see? Calc. So let's say official, there's 1,000 modules out of 4,000. Official only I'm talking about, though you need additional modules also. So 1,000 modules official one is to, let's say 30 parameter each module on an average, 30,000 options you have it. If you do not understand the pattern, you have to go through 30,000. If you understand the pattern, you have to go only one, because patterns applies. If you want to learn every module, you have to understand the pattern which is written here in this document. Let me tell you, any module you go, you find the something similar pattern. Let's go to the service module or something like that. Okay, see packaging modules. Which one you like it? Are you using Ubuntu or Red Hat family?
CentOS.
Which one?
Red Hat and CentOS.
Red Hat family.
Yum, you know, right? Yum, you know, right? Look at this Yum. See here, first read this, then read this, then go for the parameter. Same pattern. Pattern follow, so you can avoid this number. You don't get scared 30,000 number. How to use it, I'm not talking. I'm just telling you what is that. How to use it, I'll talk about it. Just give me some time. So guys, what is module? You have understood. Now, where to find out this module? Whenever you install Ansible, right, there's one system location where all this Python program and bash program will be stored. You can read it. It's not a very difficult program. Hardly each module will have a 20, 30, 40 lines of code, not more than that. It's very simple. Because why 40 lines of code? Because it will do only one thing, based on the arguments, whatever you pass. So guys, is that clear? What is a module concept? It is clear. Can I move on to the second topic? Guys?
I'm okay with module.
Okay. Now guys, what is the
point? Kind of a demo will help in terms of how do you navigate through a module kind of things.
Yes, that's what I'm saying. I'm telling you, I think I have repeated already 4 times. See, if you want to learn some tools, okay, demo is very easy. But if, okay, I'll put it in this way. If I directly started showing you the coding, okay, I don't know whether you know Ansible or don't know. But if I start showing you the directly coding, okay, you have to write this line, you have to write this line, you have to write this line. Before that, you need to know what exactly the significance of each line, right? So first understand the concept and overview. Then demo is just a matter of minutes if you understand the concept. But if you don't know the concept, then again, directly I jump to the things. Then you'll ask, what is this? What is that? What is that? So it's very difficult. So be with me. If you know Ansible, then also you be with me. If you don't know Ansible, then also you be with me. And don't worry about this. Content will be delivered as per the expectations only. But be with
me.
So because I'm defining because definition is more important. Here is important. Yeah, please tell me.
I get it. But just that, you know, while explaining concepts, it will be better if you can show a screenshot or something like what you did for modules.
I think I still didn't get what
a playbook is.
Yeah. I didn't. Wait a second. I did not said what is a playbook. Did I say playbook? Did I define the playbook? Did I not define the playbook? So you should not know playbook. When okay. I define, I will tell you. Now, second thing, I'll tell you one thing. If I put one line and start showing you the demo, then you will not understand the big picture. because that way my demo, one demo will become a 1 hour, or like that four demo means whole day is gone. So you, where is the big picture? Let's say
Rajesh, this is Velan. I think it's not like in a demo, it's like a sample or example how it looks like. For an example, if you say something about the file module, if you scroll down, you can show the example of the file module so that our people can able to see how it looks like.
So again, I'm repeating the same thing again. Guys, first thing.
Rajesh, like the way you showed modules.
Yeah,
see, wait, like wait, the way wait. When you were explaining what is the module, you are showing us what, how it looks like in the web page. Similarly, we are also looking for the other inventories and other playbook, whatever you are teaching, just show us how it looks like. That's what we are expecting.
Guys, just you need to understand me. Anything which you, it's not saying I'm denying that thing, I will not do that. But understand this stuff. We are rushing. We all are rushing. It's just 2 hours and we are rushing to do something. We want to see the demo. And I know you all have an eagerness to see the demo, but you need to understand the fact, very simple fact. I am in wattage mode. I am not in how is mode. You see that what I'm writing right now, what is module? What are the components?
Yeah, true, okay? got it, Rajesh.
I'm not integrating in the how or the mode. So we are rushing actually unnecessarily.
Rajesh.
I'm just explaining what is. I'm not teaching how it is. When I talk about how to become, then I talked about here overall big picture. Then here again, what are the Ansible? See how Ansible works. Then I display. Then I explain you all these things. So be with me. Just have a little bit of patience. Not more than that. In a day, I'll tell you. Okay, I'll give you one picture. At the end of the day, you will become a programmer. You will become a programmer. Where is that? How to become a programmer? You will become a programmer. Okay. So just be with me. I'm in the what is mode. I'm defining each and every component. See, I started here. What are the component of ACS? So I started this one and then you lost this stuff. Let me tell you here, if you do not get this, and if I cover what is this in each during demo, you will be lost because you will not be understand the big picture. So give me some time, okay?
Rajesh.
Yeah.
You said the module can be written in any programming languages, right?
Yes. It can be written in any programming language, but you will not get the platform independent. I mean, agentless functionality, you won't get it.
Okay, that means you are again restricting to when it comes to Linux, the module should be in Python. When it comes to Windows, it should be in either PowerShell or .NET, right?
Yes. Why so I'm to saying...
Get, okay, so to get the agentless facility, we are using Python and PS.NET, right?
That's correct, yes. That's 100% correct.
So if we are okay with the agent base one, then we can use any of the programming language or what?
Yeah. So in this case, what happens? Understand this conceptually. Okay, let me explain you. This is the ACS and this is the ARS. Now, Ansible job, so let's say this you have written in Java. Okay, so Ansible will do only one thing they will do. They will convert this Java package and send through SSH. WinRM and SSS I discussed. Conceptually, remember here. See here. WinRM and SSS. So it will deliver the package. The package, Java package is here. And it get exploded through SSH. Okay. And here through WinRM. Okay. Now, who will run this Java program? Who will run this Java program? So here you used to have a JRE again. When you have a JRE, then it will become an agent. With agent, because Java has to be installed also here, JRE also has to be installed here. So that way, okay, so yes, you can write that modules in any programming language, but because of agentless functionality we wanted, we go for preferred one, Python or .NET PowerShell. Make sense?
Yeah, got it.
Yeah. Okay, guys, so I think I'll need to little bit rush, else you will kill me for sure because I'm talking so much of conceptual stuff. Okay, now next thing is, what is configuration?
Rajesh, no need to rush, Rajesh. So you go along with your own way. So so far, whatever you taught us was very useful, very good.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So yeah. So what is configuration? So the guys, configuration, I said very clearly, whenever you install, you get this file, configuration file. So what is a configuration file? So it's a file, simple. It's a file located any places, but default location, etc, Ansible .cfg.
Rajesh, one moment, just guys who are already experienced in Ansible, please be patient with us, please. Let Rajesh go ahead with his own style. Thank you.
No problem. I will have a demo today only. I'll have a demo. It's just like if I explain the concept, no, for me also it's very easy. Because if I directly jump to the demo, then I will talk, okay, it's a playbook, it's a role, it's this is how we execute. Then we'll start asking basic question and I'll be having very big trouble at that time. Okay.
So
what is a configuration? So it's just a file. It's just a file. Where it is located, any places you can keep it, but default is this one. Okay. What it contains, that's important. Contains all behavior, I said behavior, of Ansible at one course, and set some of them set a default. So in a short, if I tell you, if you want to control the behavior of utility that is called Ansible is a one executable, or Ansible playbook, or many other utility, then all the behavior of that tool you can control through this. Behavior means one example I can tell you right now because it's a part of my discussion. See, this Ansible will create a SSH package or WinRM package. See, for Windows it's a WinRM package, for Linux it's a SSH package. So this package has to be created. How will define? So Ansible will take a creation of package, Ansible will take care of it. But we want to define, okay, boss, you create a SSH package, you create a Python package, you create a .NET package, this package, how you deliver through SSH, how you deliver through WinRM, how this has been decided, all this thing you can set it up here also, many other places also. But this guy has a default setup, and if you want to change the behavior, you can get it changed. For example, Ansible module locations, you can change it. Like how many times parallel this forking will happen? That means this machine, how many times at a time it will go fork? Fork means deploy the packages. How many times? How many packages at a time? So in that case, all this thing you can set it up in this. So how many options? More than 200 options are there. Okay, we will go one by one. So here, what is configuration? Is this a file? You can locate at any places, but it's here. Content, all the behavior of the Ansible, you can manage it through this file. And some of them are set a default value in this. Simple. So here, what is module? And see, components of ACS, this is covered. Now, guys, what is inventory? I think I covered, so I'm not going to talk about it. Here, same. Okay, it's a local host, or it can be list of IP address in a command over the command line, or in file, or in script, or in a directory. Now, next question is, what is playbook? Understand this. What is playbook? So, guys, playbook is just a concept. It's nothing like that, because ultimately it's a YAML file.
Yeah. So now the question is, what is playbook? So what is playbook? So question is playbook. So this is a collections of play. Simple. Okay. When I say what is a playbook, it's a collections of play in a simple way. But it will have variables. Let me put it up here. Okay, now you see that here. Remember again, recall this discussion we did already. See, when you write a playbook here, YAML file, playbook, all this thing will come along with it inside that playbook, right? So here, this is a playbook, is a collections of play. Now the question is, what is play? Correct? Collection, you know that. What is play? So play has, understand that. Play has, each play has host, I'm putting plus tasks parameter. Understand it. Now the question is, what is a host? Okay. See here. Playbook is a collections of play. But that means play one. Play two. Understand the skeleton first. I'll show you the damn simple actually. Play three. Play four. That means this is a playbook. But what is a play? So each play I said has a host and tasks. Now what is a host? It is a local host or a group of inventory. Guys, I'm not confusing you. Understand this. I said local host. That means local host, you understand, but or group of inventory. Okay. Yes, inventory here. Okay. So here, let's say your environment is a developer QA environment. So how many machines you have? Think about it logically. Logically, if you think, then you will understand this. So this is a playbook. And you want to execute in your whole environment. 100 machine is there. Do you really want to execute in the whole environment? 100 or so machines are there here. Or you want to only execute in the 3 machines. So this is called group in a simple way. Inventory represents entire environment. Again, I'm repeating. Inventory is a list of IP address, represent the entire environment. But if you don't want to execute that playbook in this all machine, only you have so many machines here in your environment, but what do you want? Only execute in this machine. This is called group. I'll come back to that topic, not now but little later. So here host is representing either you want to execute in this local host or group of inventory. Default group is default. There is one group called default. Okay, default group is all. And there's one default group, ungroup given by Ansible. But rest of the group you can create in inventory. How? I'll teach you how part later on. So now guys, you understand this host. Now what is the tasks? This is important. So each play has a host plus task specification, spec. Now what is a host? It is a local host or group, which is all or ungroup. All is in small, later will be there. And what is the task? Task is basically module and let me write it first. Collections of modules and its parameter. Simple. Collections of modules. Now, what is a module? I explained you here only. Please understand that. Each module, it will do one task. So here, what is a module? Collections of modules and the parameter. For example, task 1 is equal to module 1 and its parameter. The skeleton I'm explaining you. task 2, module 2, and its parameter. Task 3, module 3, and its parameter. Task 4, so see here, modules and parameters. And also, you have variables, operators, conditioning, and loopings, all these things at the task level. So guys, in short, what is a playbook? Playbook will have a play, okay? Play will have a task. This is the play one task, and task will have this is skeleton. Task 1, task 2, task 3. This is a skeleton. That's all. Now I said, remember, play will have a two things. One is host. Here I said play has a two thing, host and task specification. So hosts. Conceptually, it's very simple. See here. Each play, again I said, play means you will have a host. Playbook means multiple play. Each play will have a host and task. Now, what is a host? Here I said, it can be a local host or group or all. So either it can be local host or for time being all, because I have not explained you any demo, so I'll stick to that. So now the simple thing, understand that way. Understand this way. Simple thing. See here. When you execute the playbook, now you see here. Playbook. When you execute the playbook, all the this task, think about it conceptually. When you execute the playbook, this task, when a task, that's a module. Remember, module I showed you already. Here, these are the modules with their parameters. All this task and parameter execute on this one or this one. This task modules execute on this. Here also I have to write. This one or this one. This one. This one write on this one or this one. All this thing write on this one or this one. So guys, this is the playbook. Now, do you really want to see the playbook? So let me show you, just because you may be having curiosity. Okay. So example, Ansible playbook. Any playbook you open, any playbook of the anywhere you found out. See here. Simple playbook. I don't care about what is the content. Just look at the skeleton. This is a playbook. How many play you have? In this playbook, you have only one play. See, this is a hyphen. I'll teach you all this technical stuff. That's the reason I didn't want it to show you, because you will find confusion. This is the one play. This is only one play. Do we have a host and task? You see here. Hosts and tasks. Look at this here. Tasks. Okay, do you have a host has a where to execute it? Web server is the custom group. All is a inbuilt group, Ansible. Web server, where is defined? It will be defined in inventory, which is ours group. Host, what do you, task, what do you have? Module and its parameter. See that. Module, parameter. This is the module, YAM, template module, service module. Service module, this is the handler, leave it. So that's the reason I didn't want it to move on to the code. First, understand the skeleton. So here, this is the playbook. So guys, in the ACS, component of ACS, you have Ansible, is a software. Modules told you, config told you, inventory told you, roles, playbook told you. Roles I'm not covering right now, but I told you conceptually what is a roles. Conceptually, I told you is collections of playbooks and files, templates, handlers, variables. You need to know lots of other things also, but this is done. So more or less how part is done, what part is done. So now we'll have a time to go into the how part. So guys, question.
From an AWS perspective, for modules, is it EC2 instances? So those could be the examples for modules.
Yeah. You have AWS modules. So Ansible module AWS.
Can you also please give some examples over from an AWS perspective, what could be the modules, what could be the playbooks? What
would be the host? Just a few examples. These are the modules. You see, scroll down. Keep going. These are Azure modules. That's right. Top. This is the CC modules, cloud scale modules, cloud stack modules. This is a DigitalOcean modules. This is the Docker modules, Google Cloud. This page has list have a. You have 500 modules here, more than that.
So we'll have a module, and then for a specific task, we can create a playbook for a specific task.
Yeah. So you have to have a planning for before that. If you want to see here, playbook. Why you are writing playbook? It's not important to learn the playbook. It's important to do what you want to do. What you want to do. On remote server, that is important. You want to install some software, you want to uninstall some software, you want to change some file, you want to start the services, you want to stop the services, or you want to package something, you want to unpackage something, you want to delete something, or you want to call third-party libraries, API call. That means from here, you want to call something else, let's say AWS, Google Cloud, what exactly? So you have to define your logic first, what you want to do, task, project. That project will define what task, what module you will use. That module will be kept in the task section. Task will be under the task specification. Tasks will come under the play, and play come under the playbook. And then you run the playbook, then it will happen. So we'll go into that mode also. We'll go into that. Okay, guys, any other questions? So now you will not have complaint, more or less.
Can we create a dynamic inventory or groups when we execute a playbook?
Yes. What is a dynamic?
For an example, if I want to execute a playbook in a server, instead of already adding that server in the inventory list, if I directly execute the Ansible playbook and pointing that particular server, is it possible to add it in the inventory and execute the playbook?
Yes, that's possible. But the question is, understand this way. I said inventory is a list of IP address. How I get a list of IP address, I don't care. You pass over the command line, pass through the file, pass through this script. So if your script can generate list of IP address, you can pass the script, and this is called dynamic. Again, I'm repeating, if your script can script or programs, it should respond, return something. If the return of the script execution will be the list of IP address, then you can pass to the inventory, and that inventory will be used for running that playbook. So yes, that is possible, and that is called dynamic inventory. Dynamic inventory, that means your list of IP address will be generated dynamically. But how? Through script.
Which script? Any script. But which script we use it most of the time in Ansible? Most of the time, AWS. Python. And if you are using on AWS, you should be having that Python script, Azure, Google Cloud. So it's possible, very much possible. Now, do you need to write a script? I would say no. Are we having this script? Yes. Where it is? Ansible website. So all the major clouds platform scripts are already developed. You just have to go download and use it. How to use it? I'll show you the demo on that.
Rajesh is only host. So am I right? Is that I just want to know my understanding is right. Inventory is just the host, list of hosts. That's it.
List of ARS, list of A's. And by the way, ma'am, it can be single host also, local host also.
Yeah.
And one more thing, it can be Docker also. I'm not complicating in one go, but slowly. Yeah, someone was asking question.
Yeah. Can we compare Ansible with Chef and Puppet?
I have 10 minutes. I can try. Do we have any other questions apart from that? No questions, then I can
One more. If you say inventory, if I say complete AWS, so it would take all the instances, or I can put a part of instances which can be a local.
No, that is a conditional. That's again, you have to write a script for that. See, it's okay. Very simple concept. Think about it. I will forget about the Ansible. I will ask you just a second. Hold on one second. You know English? That's very good. Thank you. Sorry, guys. Yeah. So here, the question was, how can I get the EC2 instance? Forget about the Ansible. I will tell you one thing. Write a script which will fetch the list of IP address from the instance which is under this VPC or under this subnet or under this label with this label. So can you write this script or not? Is it difficult?
Yeah, that will be easy. Yeah.
That's all. So that script which will return the list of IP address, I need to pass to Ansible. That's all. Now, for minimizing our effort, this kind of script already has been written by community and shared on the AWS Amazon website. In fact, you can find the same script on AWS website also. Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Now I get it.
Yeah. So any other questions before going for the this topic? Last question, which is,
Can you go up? So you define the roles, right? Development and operation ops.
Yeah.
Okay. So my understanding here is, so the development team will develop a module and the ops team will utilize it. This is the explain?
No. Module development is a different word, work altogether. Yes, that can be used as a development module development also. But my real intention was to tell you, development team will develop a role. Role will have a playbook, and that playbook you test it first in the local host. That means your own machine. If it is working, then you give it through the Git or something to the operation, and operations will apply that role in infrastructure like let's say. You develop a playbook in a production development environment. After that, operations will apply in the QA environment, integration environment, pre-production environment, and all the stuff like that. Depends on your requirement.
So both development and ops will play with the playbook, not with the module.
Because module is inside a playbook, no? Here I said
no. Module is being written by someone else.
Okay, there is a two thing. understand this way. Are you talking about the default module, or you are talking about the module which has been written by your organization? Tell me.
No, you said some copy and services, right? Those modules. I'm talking about those modules.
That is the default module. So module, in this case, module is not written by anyone else, but given by when you install Ansible. Let me show you that area. Here. See here, components, where is that? Here it is. So when you install the component Ansible modules and configuration, you get along with it.
Okay.
But here I said, what is a module? No one is writing a module for now. Yes, you can write it if you want it. But I think there were some questions for those also. But I am saying for beginners, you are not writing modules. But I am telling you what is a module. Module is a written code, a piece of code which is already written and comes along with the Ansible installation. Which are the modules? These are the modules which I showed you.
Mm-hmm.
So got now it, the man. Question, yeah, understood that?
Yeah, I got it.
Yeah, so your job is to write a playbook and role, not a module right now. Okay?
Okay.
Yeah, so now any other questions? Okay, so let's get into the
Rajesh, one more question. If I want to say write some play for enabling versioning for S3 buckets in AWS, S3 buckets doesn't have any IP address, so in that case, how will the inventory look like?
Sorry, I did not understand your question.
See, for example, I'm writing a play. That play is going to enable versioning for AWS S3 buckets. It doesn't going to do anything with the instances or any other servers.
Right, yeah.
So in this case, the list of S3 buckets, right? S3 buckets doesn't have any IP addresses. So in this case, how will the inventory look like?
Okay, so in this case, you have to understand the architecture first. That's the reason I focus more on architecture, because this kind of questions can be avoided if you understand the architecture. See here. This is a ACS. Now, forget about the inventory right now. This is a AWS. AWS can connect to any machine through API. Okay? Understand this. API. Not through inventory. Don't need, if you want to version AWS, or you want to create an AWS instance, or you want to create a DB or anything. I said anything means anything. 99.99% of AWS service is available through API. API means HTTP protocol, HTTPS protocol. What you need? Access code and access ID, secret ID. So now, if you write a playbook, and you want to enable the versioning of S3. So you need to communicate the API of AWS, not through the inventory, inventory. Yeah. Now this command, API command, the command which will run from the ACS or through run the ARS is up to you define ACS. Okay, that you define. You want to run directly from the ACS or you run through the ARS. That you define. Most of this activity you will done through the ACS only, local host mode. Okay, but next question is, how this connections will be made? For that, there is a module start there. Connection. Go up. Okay, this is a GCP, Azure, this is the EC2. So do you have any module for it? S3 versioning, see here. These are the S3 related. Here you can manage the bucket. So you have a here. Look at this here, this module. S3 bucket. They can manage. And let me check the parameter versioning is there or not. See here. Some version is there. I have to read it actually. See here. Versioning is there, but what context they're using for getting or modifying, enabling, that you have to check. So did you understand this conceptually?
Yeah, then so the play will run on the remote server, and then the remote server will call AWS through API and do whatever we
So when you call the module, module is not running. See, these some there's a two kind of module. One module will do the server change, one module will do the API request. So the module which you are talking about, which will not do the changes, which will do the API request. For API request, you need the keys. So any module you have to give, see here, this your module only, S3 module, and this you need the keys to API request. So this will not do changes in that machine where you are running. It will make a
So Rajesh, so the ARS can be connected using inventory and API calls and anything else?
Hello?
Actually, we lost for a while.
Okay, sorry. Yeah. So did you understand that question? Hello?
Yeah,
Rajesh, yeah, we are able to hear you. Can I add something to your point, Rajesh, just to clarify them?
Yeah.
The question was like, you know, how to, handle with the S3 buckets, since S3 buckets cannot be listed in the inventories. So since Rajesh mentioned it is going to connect over the API using the Python modules, respective Python modules. And ultimately, the inventory will be the local host, or it can be defined to the remote host. You can, in the inventory, you can mention the remote host from where that Python call has to go to the S3 bucket. Also, you have to configure the AWS access keys in your playbook. So to answer simply, yes, the inventory will be the local host when you're running when you're handling such kind of resources.
So the local host in the mean, it is the ACS, am I right?
Yeah, ACS.
Yeah.
Yeah. Also, it can be a ARS.
It can be ARS also.
Yeah.
Any machines you can run it, but ultimately this changes will not happen in the same machine. It will do the API call.
Okay, Rajesh. Now,
last
one. The ARS can be contactor or connected through inventory and using inventory and API calls. Anything else is there to connect? So only through inventory or API calls?
Nothing, you just need a permission. But one more thing, if you run API call, let's say API call, how do you make it? So you need to have AWS command line set. So whichever the machine you run, okay, you have to have some prerequisite to do that. If you're calling the API call through the command line or through curl or through something else, you have to have those stuff in play. Okay. But if you use the module, your life will be easier because here they will make sure that all this thing is there.
Okay. To connect the ARS, you can use any other plugins?
If you don't want to use Ansible, directly you make install the AWS and run the command, it will be done. Now if you want to do through the Ansible, then Boto 3 has to be installed. Now what is a Boto 3? So Boto 3 is a collections of AWS cloud modules which has been implemented, so you have to install the Boto 3. So there's different ways to do that. Conceptually, if you understand, then you are good with it.
Or you can have a IAM role set to that specific EC2 nodes.
Those are permission. Permission and authentication, authorization, I'm not at all talking about. Okay, guys, let's move on to this topic, which is pending. So now what is the difference between Ansible, Puppet, Chef, and Salt? These are the main tools which we have, and there's one more tool which is called CF Engine. Okay, now by the way, I have not worked with the Salt and CF Engine, so I cannot comment anything, but I have worked with Ansible, Puppet, and Chef a lot, so I can comment here. So by the way, who's the market leader? Ansible. Puppet is the second market leader. Third one is a Chef. So Ansible, Puppet, Chef. Okay. First thing, common thing.
all can be done through Ansible, all can be done through Puppet, all can be done through Chef. Simple, no more arguments. Anything which you can do with the Ansible, you can do with the Puppet. Anything we do with the Puppet, you can do with the Chef. There should not be any agreement. So many people compare, okay, this feature is there, that feature is not there. That is a, I feel it's not, it's just a waste of time. Because I know can be possible through any of these two. But approach is important, approach, okay? So Ansible has been developed using Python, which is more user-friendly. Puppet has been developed using Ruby, which very less people know that because it's not a part of the every machines, every system automation, okay? Now, Puppet uses the SSH protocol and HTTP protocol, where this guy always uses the TCP protocol, okay? Here TCP. So for here, agentless, because of Python is agentless. But here you need an agent. But let me tell you, Puppet has recently introduced agentless also. So like that, okay? Here you write in that YAML file, that playbook, okay? Here we write in .rb file. And here we write chef, we write, there's opposite. Puppet PP, Puppet program we write. And this we write in RB file, okay? Now, here we call it playbook. Here we call it module. Don't get confused with Ansible module. This is a different thing. And here we call it playbook. Here we call it module. And here we call it cookbook. Here we call it module. Roles. Here we call it multiple playbook role. Here we call it puppet. This we call it manifest. And this we call it module. Sorry, I messed up. It's very difficult to sometimes. So module, manifest we call it, and here we call it module. Here we call it cookbook, and here we call it roles. Okay, role. Now, what difference you want more? Any specific difference, any specific area?
Like Jinja in Ansible?
Here Jinja. So here we use Jinja for the templating. Here we use here we use a manifest template, which is a Ruby template. And here we also Ruby template because it's a programming language. Jinja, why? Because Python use Jinja. Ruby template here. Now one more thing, system information. Here we use factor. Here we use factor also. And here we use OHAI. OHAI or something like that. OHAI. Yeah, system fact information for that. These are the things. Any other specific area?
What is mean by factor?
Factor is a system information. Like Ansible, if you know, then you remember the setup module, which is a fact template also work on the same. Conditioning also happen in the subfact. I'll talk about the variable type, then I'll discuss. Yeah, but this is important, guys. No matter how it works, terminology, no matter how it's been used, everything can be done, everything. Approach is different. Make sense? Any other questions, guys?
So Ansible is push-based methodology, right?
No, sir. Push-pull both is possible. Because we don't know the feature, so that's the reason sometime what happens, we assume, but I know all three, so I can tell you push-pull is both the places, all three places. I don't know about the salt, so I cannot comment. Chef engine also,
so
I don't
know. Without agent, how the pull works in Ansible?
So there is a one different agent actually for the pushing, pulling, okay? Ansible pull agent. Ansible pull utility, which you have get it, you will have to get it actually. So you have to, the moment you install the Ansible, you get Ansible-pull, you can configure it and it will pull the playbooks from the any places and it will, no problem. Makes sense?
Okay. Yeah.
By the way, agent you have in many people say agentless. Let me tell you, Ansible also we have an agent. Okay, Ansible also which you can install it. Ansible. So an agent is also there, but people don't use it because of SSH is there. So don't use the Ansible agent. Everyone got used to it, so people don't know those. But agent is there in Ansible.
Rajesh, you aren't talking, right?
I'm talking.
Hello.
Yeah, we can able to hear him. Yeah, we can able to hear him. Tamil, do you have any problem?
Okay, guys, any other questions? Okay, so I think we will give the rest to all this stuff. Now I will show you the demo. So if you have understood this notes, all these things, then trust me, demo is just a matter of formalities, because just I have to give you some commands and you are done with it. You are done with the task. So that's all.
If you liked our Ansible session so far, please enroll for our channel membership $399 plan to get access of all the parts. Along with that, you can access our other tutorials such as Docker, Ansible, Jenkins, Terraform, Splunk, AWS, Azure, and various other DevOps-related premium tutorials with our channel membership. If you would have any issues with our channel membership, you can drop an email to us at contact@devopschool.com, or you can also unsubscribe from channel membership anytime if you don't want to continue or did not like the video. To get our channel membership, click onto the join button, select the $399 plan, and grow your skills immensely.
Please be kind enough to like it, and you can comment any of your doubts and queries. We will reply to them at the earliest.
Thanks for watching.